ventilation. It is starting from the time of the birth and even before the birth of the baby. This is Latifa Women and Children Hospital in Dubai. We accept around 7,000 annual births, and 20% of them are preterm babies. And from those preterm babies, 65% are the late preterm. We are a tertiary unit. We are having the sensor medics. We are having the nitric oxide. And we are a referral center in Dubai. Usually, I like to start my presentation by a case discussion. And this, what we are facing now in our practice. We're having a preterm mother or a mother which is 35 years old, and she's having a preterm delivery with premature rupture of membrane for 36 hours, and abruptio placenta and fetal distress. The baby was born and with Apgar score of 4 and 7 at 1 and 5 minutes respectively. He was delivered by cesarean section. He was not having respiratory effort, intubated and connected to assist control. After connection to ventilation, this was the X-ray, and as you can see that this is X-ray typical of respiratory distress syndrome. The baby received the Cerventa and was connected later on or shifted to low parameters of ventilation, and he was maintaining his CO2 level between the 45 and the 50s, and this was the X-ray on the end of the first day. So you can see here that the lung is expanded. Yes, we can see some air bronchogram and mild bilateral infiltration. And we can consider it after starting the Cerventa, we can consider it that this is mild HMD versus the congenital pneumonia in view of the premature rupture of membrane for 36 hours. On day 12, the baby needed to be re-intubated, and we can see that his blood gas deteriorated with PCO2 retention, and this was the X-ray. So he was re-intubated, and this was the X-ray. As you can see here that the X-ray is showing a bilateral fluffy cotton appearance, and it is the what we see now. It is the chronic lung disease or the early chronic lung disease by the new definition by Ellenger. So this baby was, despite of conventional ventilation, he didn't tolerate and he was shifted to high frequency ventilation. So let's speak about chronic lung disease or the lung injury itself and how it is important for us as neonatologists and what is the impact of this on our management. So as we can see that there is increasing prevalence of premature deliveries all over the world, and yet we still having a problem with the extreme preterm babies ranging between the 23 and 26 gestational age. It affects the chronic lung disease, affects the 40 to 70% of those who are less than 1 kilo. And as you will come to see later on, that the pathophysiology here is a multifactorial in origin. As you can see here that the incidence of chronic lung disease is increasing all over the years, and this is because we are having much more deliveries of extreme preterm babies. And the relation between the severity of the chronic lung disease and the gestational age, the less the gestational age, the more severe the chronic lung disease or the lung injury. I will mention it, that it is lung injury, and it is due to surfactant deficiency, inability to immediate recruit the lung at birth, the premature antioxidant system of the preterm babies, the structure of the premature lung itself, as we will come to see, the compliant chest wall of the preterm babies, and increase in the capillary permeability that will lead to the biotrauma. So, is it important, the chronic lung disease? Yes, because we are having both cases. It will lead to morbidities and mortalities. So up to 50% will die in the first year from the chronic lung disease, and multiple prolonged and recurrent hospitalization. And it will be shown in the pediatric age group as chronic lung disease. So does it need follow-up? Yes, it needs a long-term follow-up with a multidisciplinary teams. It needs the pulmonologist, it needs the dietitians for the proper caloric intake. It will need the physiotherapist or developmental care team to take care of this baby, and it will need also the neonatologist. So it is a long-term disease and affecting the baby up to the adulthood life. So what is the pathophysiology? As we mentioned, that the pathophysiology of the chronic lung disease or the lung injury itself starts from I will start by definition. The definition was started by a radiological definition by Northway in 1967, and it was related to the condition in correlation with the radiological findings and pathological criteria itself. What happened later on, the X-ray classification graded the lung injury or the bronchopulmonary dysplasia. So let's go to this important slide, which will show us the what is happening with us here. This is the secular formation of the alveoli and the subdivision to saccules, starts between 28 and 36. This is very wide range, and what we are facing now is we see the babies in the canalicular phase. This is the extreme preterm babies, less than 28 weeks, which are having much less arborization and alveolarization as compared to the those who are delivered in the secular stage. This is more evident in this slide, and as you can see, the difference between the secular stage here and the canalicular stage, which are having the new BPD, is big. And there are many levels of arborization is missing whenever we are having extreme preterm babies. As you can see here, that we are having an antenatal problem that can lead to the chronic lung disease, and we will discuss it in details. And that's why the lecture is long. And we are having the postnatal exposure, and also these will be discussed in details during the lecture. As we mentioned, that the canalicular stage with the developmental arrest or delay in the So I don't have the secular formation. So this is will lead to the new BPD as defined by Alan Job in 2020 and was updated in 2005. As compared to the secular or alveolar stage, which led to the old chronic lung disease as defined by Northway. So the prenatal event that can lead to the lung injury is the chorioamnionitis and the cytokine exposure of the fetus. And this will lead to lung injury and release of inflammatory cytokines. And this will lead to the development of the BPD. In the postnatal event, so it is a disease starting before delivery. And during delivery, we are having a big role, and this will be discussed in a while. And after delivery, we are having another role for the management or prevention of this disease. As you can see here, the difference between the old BPD, that the lung is really having the fluffy cotton appearance and the over-congested lung, as compared to this smooth lung with a new BPD on the right side. As we mentioned, the difference is the gestational age, the weight, the maturity of the baby, the severity of the lung disease itself. You can see that the fibrosis is happening in the old chronic lung disease, while it is minimal. It is there, it is available in the new BPD, but it is minimal than the old type. So coming to the pathology, the pathology of the old BPD is, you can see that the lung is emphysematous with the areas of atelectasis, some area of fibrosis, while in the new BPD, you are having decrease in the alveolar number and the alveolar hypoplasia. Then we will come to the relation between the chorioamnionitis and BPD. So, is there any relation between chorioamnionitis and chronic lung disease? According to the studies from the Canadian networks, they are telling that the clinical chorioamnionitis is having increased incidence with the intraventricular hemorrhage, early neonatal sepsis, but it is not related to the respiratory outcome. So chorioamnionitis isolated to the placenta and the chorion was associated with decrease in the respiratory distress syndrome, while chorioamnionitis with fetal involvement increased the risk for the respiratory distress syndrome. So what will happen if the infant is exposed to this severe chorioamnionitis, there will happen, what will happen, that the response to surfactant is decreased. And this will lead to development of the lung injury. And as you can see here, that with the histological chorioamnionitis, you can see that the more the preterm or the lesser the gestational age, the more the chorioamnionitis is occurring, or there is a relation between the chorioamnionitis and the prematurity, and hence it will lead to the development of chronic lung disease. Through increasing the intra amniotic cytokines, which will cause a systematic or systemic fetal response, leading to increase in the inflammatory markers, and this will lead to the risk of chronic lung disease. So this will take me for the second question. Does the antenatal steroid will reduce the chronic lung disease or not? As we know that antenatal steroid is advisable for ladies who are in labor and especially the preterm babies, and to be given at least 12 hours before birth. But whether this antenatal steroid will prevent the chronic lung disease or not, this is what we will see here, that the consensus statement recommends antenatal steroid for potential preterm between 24 to 34. As you can see here from this systematic review, that the antenatal steroid reduced the chronic the respiratory distress syndrome. You can see it here. It didn't reduce the respiratory distress syndrome less than 28 weeks, but it reduced the all respiratory distress syndrome, including those who are up to 34 weeks. It reduced the surfactant use, yes, but what happened? It didn't reduce, on the contrary, you're having shift to the right for the BPD, and hence the antenatal glucocorticoids will not decrease the incidence of lung injury. Now we will go to the delivery room and how our management in the delivery room and the first golden hour management will differ in the preterm babies, minimizing their chronic lung disease. As we know all that during the delivery room management, we are giving the baby the oxygen, we are giving AmboBag, we expose the baby to the cold stresses and the dry gas of the oxygen. We are some of us are not giving the proper PEEP to recruit the alveoli or stent the alveoli until surfactant is given. And the early indication of surfactant and temperature control, because these are the points which are under the cover of the title of the golden hour for the preterm babies, and how it will affect the prognosis of the babies. And the idea of the golden hour is to mimic the circumstances of the preterm delivery, mimicking the intrauterine atmosphere till the baby is stabilized in the incubator. So, shall we use the oxygen or room air during resuscitation? According to the latest guidelines of the neonatal resuscitation program, the seventh edition, if the preterm baby is born, it is advisable not to use oxygen more than 30% and titrated with the oxygen saturation monitoring, and this will help to prevent the oxidative stresses from the oxygen toxicity later on. This is regarding the oxygen. What about the use of CPAP versus mechanical ventilation? Earlier, we were using the AmboBag, and the, as we all know that the AmboBag, we can deliver pressures up to 40 without control. So I cannot control the pressures with each breath of the AmboBag. And hence now it is advisable to use the new puff or the T-piece, where I can give the proper pressures, whether PIP or the PEEP, during the all the breathers together. Keep in mind that giving excessive pressures, which is the PIP, is associated with, again, increase in the release of cytokines. Please take care, cytokines is mentioned here. Cytokines is mentioned with the chorioamnionitis. And so cytokines or the inflammatory mediators are coming from different origin also. Also, if I'm not giving the proper PEEP, it is here written no PEEP because I intentionally put it, because if I give a PEEP of 3 or 4, that means I'm not giving the proper PEEP for this preterm babies, because the 4 is 2 of them will go to the lung, because I'm having 2 for going for the dead space. So the baby will have 2 out of the 4. So this will not be enough to inflate all the alveoli or recruit all the alveoli. And this will lead again to increase in the cytokine production. So recommendation for the oxygen is start with 30%. I can titrate based on the algorithm of the NRP. I'm not in a hurry to increase the oxygen saturation of the preterm babies in the first and second minutes, or the third even. Up to 5 minutes, I can wait to reach to the 90s. This is the new practice in the neonatal resuscitation. So I'm avoiding the oxygen toxicity syndrome. So brief exposure to high oxygen concentration can initiate a lung injury resulting in bronchopulmonary dysplasia. So use of room air or lowest concentration, Dr. Ola Sugdad is behind the oxygen, low oxygen use or the room air versus the recommendation from the states before the latest NRP guidelines that were liberal in the use of the oxygen. So now it is recommended to use less oxygen, and this led to the decrease in the incidence of the chronic lung disease among the survival of this multi-center, seven-center survey. So this we mentioned that the use of ambo bag with a T-manometer or the P piece is very important. And this will help giving the babies the proper pressures all through the breaths. The CPAP work best if started immediately in the delivery room. This is the T-piece. All of us know the T-piece, and I can adjust the PIP, and I can adjust the PEEP versus the ambo bag with the manometer. This can work in if I'm not having the T-piece, but make sure that I will give the continuous pressure without exceeding the recommended pressure to recruit the line. Let's see what will happen during the first 5 breaths of ambo bagging preterm babies. As you can see that the epithelial injury have been detected during the up to six positive pressure breaths. And this is the, you can see if I'm giving a high pressure with the ambo bag without controlling the pressures, I can lead to this lung in 20 minutes. Again, here I'm having release of the cytokines in the lung. So let's go further and see what is the role of surfactant in decreasing the chronic lung disease. So the surfactant will reduce the, again, this is a multicentral systematic review in the Cochrane, and you can see that the surfactant reduced the pneumothorax and reduced also the chronic lung disease or the lung injury. So does postnatal steroid decrease the BPD? So this is another question. As you know that steroid were used in the 90s and early 2000s, and it was then stopped because of development of neurodevelopmental delays in many babies. So it was advised to not to be generous in using the steroids because of the growth failure and the increased incidence of the cerebral palsy. So what about inhaled steroid? The meta-analysis showed that early use of inhaled steroid led to earlier extubation, but didn't affect the chronic lung disease or the lung injury and mortality, because as we'll come to see that the chronic lung disease or the lung injury is a multifactorial. So what about the corticosteroid therapy? The corticosteroid, as we mentioned, decreased the incidence of the respiratory distress syndrome, but didn't reduce the incidence of the chronic lung disease. So the use of corticosteroid to treat or prevent the VPD remain controversial, and it is based on the case progression. So now the early use of low-dose postnatal steroid shows promising in improvement of the short-term outcome, but it didn't affect the long-term outcome. So the idea is here to to use short courses early in life, and this will lead to shorter time on the ventilation, but there is a possibility for risk for the CPD, cerebral palsy in the follow-up clinic. So inhaled steroid versus systemic, as we mentioned, there is no evidence in the difference in the adverse effect. But the systemic effect of steroid is diminished, and still there is an indication for longer trials to know the proper dosing and schedules for the prevention or prevention of the neurodevelopmental outcome. So we can see here that we can use combination of the inhaled steroid and postnatal steroid, or we can use the postnatal steroid together with the intratracheal instillation of surfactant, and this is the new latest recommendation. Can we use it to prevent the chronic lung disease? It is still we cannot adopt a clinical practice to recommend this protocol. So is there any relation between the ductus arteriosus and the PDA? There is clear association between both, and that's why we can see the correlation between the presence of the X-ray that we have seen in the beginning on day 12. And this can be seen even in starting from day 5, where it is the typical days for the symptomatic ductus occurrence, with increase in the oxygen requirement, increase in the ventilatory need, and some of the cases will have a pulmonary hemorrhage. So the PDA by itself will cause pulmonary blood flow to the lung. This will increase the interstitial lung fluid that will lead to decrease in the pulmonary compliance from the wet lung. So in this baby, I'll be having a decrease in the compliance and increasing in resistance. This will lead to the higher ventilatory parameters and oxygen concentration. Now let's come to the main topic of this or main part of this lecture, whether the ventilation technique will make a difference. So what is the goal of mechanical ventilation? The goal of the mechanical ventilation is to establish functional residual capacity, and this will improve the compliance and will improve the gas exchange. Also, it will provide adequate volume, and this volume will help to support and stent the alveoli and will minimize the atelectasis. And if I'm using the adequate volume, I will prevent the over-distension of the alveoli. So I'm preventing, by using the adequate volume, I'm preventing the swinging that we'll come to see in a while. So here, how I will ventilate, I will open the lung, bust to the pressure at which the atelectasis will occur. Then after opening the lung, I will maintain the lung opened above the critical closing pressure. So I'll prevent the critical closing pressure. So I want to bypass the critical opening pressure, and I want to prevent the lung from going to the below the critical closing pressure. And by the way, Virginia Apgar in 1952 was the first who spoke about the lung injury. And she mentioned that it is from the distension and not the pressure. It is not only the pressure, but it is the time. So it is a time given with a pressure, it is a volume, so it is a multifactorial injury to the lung. As we can see here from this lung, that volutroma will lead to the chronic lung disease, the barotrauma, atelectotrauma, the biotrauma, which is related to the cytokines release, whether from antenatal time or the birth time, or the infection that occurs after the birth, and they added to it the rheotrauma, which is the using of the flow that needed to keep the pressures peak to open the lungs. So as we can see here, that overinflation will give me excessive end inspiratory volume, excessive inspiratory time, excessive PEEP, or inadequate PEEP. I like to mention it is inadequate PEEP. If I'm not giving the proper PEEP, the injurious to the lung is not the PEEP. The injurious to the lung is the delta P, which is the difference between the PIP and the PEEP, as we'll come to see from the graphs which I quoted from Martin Kessler. Let's see here this cartoon or this photo of this child who is trying to blow a balloon. And you can see his face, he's in pain, or he's he's doing effort to open the balloon. And still his pressure to open the balloon is not enough. What will happen here, he gave higher pressure to open the balloon, but unfortunately the balloon ruptured. And this is the excessive volume went inside, ruptured, and this rupture of the balloon will lead to, again, increase in the cytokines, as we've come to see. You can see the picture on the right side that the child has given the proper pressure and the balloon is opened, and you can see even his face, the face is now more relaxed and he is not exerting any more pressure. So we are speaking about atelectotrauma. If I'm not giving the proper functional residual capacity, what will happen to the terminal alveoli? It will collapse at the end of expiration. The repeated opening and closing of those alveoli will cause shearing of these alveoli and will lead to rupture of the airway, leading to the lung injury. You can see the same here, what we spoke about. Here I want to open the alveoli behind the critical opening pressure, and I want to prevent the alveoli from closing here at the critical closing pressure. So remember always, this will be with us for the next few slides, the pressure volume curve. Remember the critical opening pressure, critical closing pressure. Here we are having a peaking where I'm having over distension of alveoli, and this is injurious to the alveoli. And here I'm having another peaking with atelectasis of the alveoli, and this also is injurious to the alveoli. You can see here from this pressure volume curve that I'm giving pressure to open the alveoli, but this pressure is not enough to open the lung. You can see that the lung is not open. You can see here that I'm giving nearly the same pressure that I gave here, but what happened to the volume? You can see that the volume that reached the lung is higher than this volume. Why? Because I bypassed the critical opening pressure. Let's go to this final pressure volume here. I'm giving the same pressure, but what happened to the volume? I'm not having more volume because already the lung is overdistended because I'm having a high functional residual capacity. So the second point is the biotrauma, and this we mentioned, it is related to the biological mechanism and the interleukin and the cytokines released at different times of the ventilation. All these cytokines will lead to not only disease of the lung, it will lead to a multi-organ failure or multi-organ dysfunction of the baby, and we'll see that the baby is edematous, we'll see that the baby might go into hypotension, and even a renal problem can happen, all this due to the inflammatory cytokine. The rheotrauma, it is the flow used to open the pressures, and if I'm using a higher flow, and it is recommended not to be more than 6, in very extreme preterm babies, I can go higher up to 8, but if I'm not using the proper flow, I'll not be able to open the alveoli as it is in this slide. So let's come now to the ventilation. So let's agree that no single mode of ventilation is safe. All modes of ventilation, and that's why the recommendation from the Columbia School is not to ventilate and keep the baby on the NeoBlend or the bubble CPAP like they are using. And if I'm using the ventilation, I should use the ventilation that will not harm the baby. So consider non-invasive ventilation, choose the right tidal volume, choose the right PEEP, choose the right ventilator strategy. The best ventilator is not to ventilate at all and use the bubble CPAP. And you can see that centers with strong CPAP committed tend to have lower rates of BPD. And this is the center of Wong and Hani Ali in Colombia. They accept the permissive hypercapnia and they accept the saturation goal between 90 to 95 and attempt extubation to nasal CPAP or nasal IMV as soon as possible. The proper tidal volume, as we mentioned, we should use a tidal volume above the inflection point, which is the critical opening pressure, and I don't want the alveoli to collapse at the critical closing pressure. Using the right PEEP, and as we mentioned here, that the PEEP used for the normal lung is between 4 and 5, the normal lung. What about the PEEP in the preterm babies? I am sure that we should use the higher PEEP to maintain the functional residual capacity. So again, I should use the PEEP to bypass the critical opening pressure and this inflection point. This is the graph from Martin Kessler with his permission. You can see here that this is the inspiration and this is the expiration. This is the pressure of the ventilated baby and this is the PEEP. You can see here that if I'm not giving the proper pressure and I'm not giving the proper PEEP, what will happen? The lung is sheared here because I cannot open, I cannot keep it open. So I cannot open it first and I cannot keep it opened, and this will lead to a electrotrauma. You can see here from this pressure volume curve, I'm giving a high delta P, which is a high pressure, But you can see here that the functional residual capacity is not enough to keep the alveoli patent. Why? Because I'm not giving the proper PEEP. So I'm giving a high delta P. This will give me a high tidal volume that will cause injury to the lung, but still I'm not opening or I'm not having the proper functional residual capacity. You can see here, if I'm giving the adequate PEEP, what will happen? That my functional residual capacity increased, my delta P reduced, and my tidal volume increased. So this, what we aim is to give the proper pressures, whether PIP or PEEP for the babies. If I'm not giving the proper PIP, I'm giving a high PEEP while keeping the PEEP normal or adequate. Again, I'm having good functional residual capacity, but what happened to the delta P? The delta P increased. So this will lead to more tidal volume, and this is again injurious to the lung. And this shows me that the difference between this slide and this slide, whenever I'm giving the proper pressures. While I'm using the high frequency ventilation, I'm not using PEEP. I'm using a high rate with small tidal volume, and this will lead to the both the cycles are going together, the inspiration and the inspiration. I cannot say that the baby is having inspiration and expiration in the high frequency, because both are going simultaneously. Then right ventilator mode we should choose, whether the so the best answer for this, whatever mode of ventilation you are happy with, use it, but use it judiciously. So don't say that the ventilator this mode failed until you reach its maximum. You put the baby on pressure support plus volume guarantee. The next day you find that the doctor stopped the volume guarantee, and you will start the volume guarantee. Keeping changes of the mode of the ventilation will affect the hemodynamics of the baby, not only at the level of the lung, it can affect at the level of the brain and lead to the chronic the IVH or sometimes hypoxia. Let's see here the difference between the high frequency and the conventional. You can see in conventional, I'm swinging between the orange areas. And what we want to avoid is the over-distension and the atelectasis. And while in high frequency, I'm having supraphysiological, low tidal volume, supraphysiological rate, was sub-physiological tidal volume. So I'm giving the ventilation to the baby in the safe zone. This is the, I like to show the normal lung here. You can see that this is the lung during inflation, and this is during the expiration in the absence of surfactant. This in presence of surfactant, this is the lung inflated, and this is the during expiration. This is the lung during the high frequency. It is wiggling. The lung is wiggling. You cannot say that there is inflation and deflation. This is the lung while and as you see, if I'm not using the proper pressure, I'm not against the conventional. No, conventional is very good if I'm using the proper pressures. Let's go to the high frequency. You can see here that I'm giving a superphysiological rate with suboptimal tidal volume, and this will help opening the and recruiting all the alveoli. So what about the drugs? Because of the sake of the time, I know I'm late now. So caffeine, can we use it? Yes, caffeine will reduce the apnea of prematurity and will lead to a better lung function and will reduce the incidence of chronic lung disease in this. Vitamin E, although it is used, But the one that was used before the 2011 is the intramuscular, and the number need to treat is 11. So you treat 11 cases with four intramuscular injections for 4 weeks. This will help reduce the incidence of IVH in one of 11 treated. So whether it is worth it or not, I'm not sure, because to keep the baby four times a day for 4 weeks, it is long. So vitamin E and BPD, although it is decreased in the treatment group, but it is the number need to treat again, it is should be considered. So it is one for 14 or 15. Sorry, I mentioned it is one over 11. The diuretics, shall we use? Yes, BBT is associated with increased permeability, increased hydrostatic pressure, especially if there is a PDA and there is a fluid overload. So diuretic induced the rapid improvement of the lung compliance. And the literature is replete with the cases of toxicity in some cases, especially the preterm babies with risk of nephrocalcinosis, and some of the cases of reopening of the ductus. So the bronchodilators, whether to use or no, we mentioned that there is evidence of increased airway resistance in the chronic lung disease, so it can be used, but take care of the side effects such as tachycardia, hypertension, and arrhythmia. Nutrition is very important role, and this will help management the decreased caloric intake, which I am avoiding in view of the respiratory distress syndrome or respiratory distress itself, or the swallowing dysfunction itself, or the decrease in the motility with the gastric residue in the preterm babies, and the decrease in the intake also in suspecting patent ductus arteriosus, whether or the increase in the metabolic expenditure, such as increase in the work of breathing, tachypnea, and tachycardia. So our aim is to give the caloric intake, supplemental oxygen, and mechanical ventilation, and the nutrition optimal, we should give, the weight gain should be around 20 to 30 grams per day, averaged over the week. The excellent nursing care is very important, and they are going hand in hand with the doctors. On the contrary, they are having much more role than us, because they are observing the baby day and night. They will keep the suctioning minimal as indicated. So we are not now recommending the 3-hourly suctioning. We are having the observation of the bedside functional pulmonary function, titrating the oxygen, and I will not speak about the ECMO in our cases. There is a role for the respiratory syncytial virus immunoprophylaxis, that it will reduce the complication or rehospitalization of the chronic lung disease. Wheezing can occur in chronic lung disease. The BPD is not just the lung. As we mentioned, we are having a multidisciplinary team for the chronic lung disease. We are having complication of pulmonary infection. We are having outcome can lead to need of tracheostomy. Some of the babies will go home on ventilation. Some of the baby will have increased incidence of reflux, pulmonary infection, especially during the season of respiratory syncytial virus. And the prevention is better than the cure. As we mentioned here, that the chronic lung disease is multifactorial and can affect the preterm babies, and lead one of the most common complications is the pulmonary hypertension. And the take-home message: use the non-invasive ventilation, apply exogenous Cerventa by the new technology, LISA, or the Ensure, use the volume instead of the pressure, use the synchronized ventilation instead of the CPAP after the extubation. This is my references, and thank you very much.
شكرا استاذنا دكتور.